As we sang the praise of him who died, inscribed upon the cross, we saw in shining letters, God is love. And you know, God does love you. Make no mistake about that, God loves you. No matter where you are in your experience today, God loves you. And it's a wonderful thing for God's people to do this, to remember, to behold what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us. Every time we are entering into a new phase of our ministry and fellowship with God in our lives. Just throw out all the anchors for a moment this morning and consider how God has poured his love upon you. Every believer can write over it, "Hitherto hath the Lord helped us." And to God we turn and say, for all that is gone, great is thy faithfulness. But I believe that the word of God would say to us all this morning, all the children of God, remember ye not the former things, neither consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall ye not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness, and rivers in the desert. Isaiah chapter 43, verse 18 and 19. God wants to do a new thing, not only for you, but with you. But he wants to do it now. Now it shall spring forth. And you must be willing. He says, shall ye not know it? Will you own God's hand in it? He won't force it upon you against your will. He knows that some of us have settled on our lees. He knows that some of us have decided it's time to take things a bit easier. God's saying, will you know it? Shall you not know it? Will you take this step of faith in God today? Will you let God do a new thing for you and with you from this day forth and say to you this morning, from this day will I bless you? If you're not saved, watching on the video just now, will you experience the new birth today? Will you receive new life in Christ today? Will you become a new creature with a new song in your mouth, looking for a new heaven today? If you were to ask me to crystallize what I want to say and what I believe I have to say in this meeting this morning, it's this. God wants to create for you and with you a new beginning. But he wants you to make it a right beginning. Now I'm going to say that again. God wants to create for you and with you a new beginning. But he wants you to make it a right beginning. How do we do that, George? Turn with me, if you will, to Mark chapter 8, please. Mark chapter 8 and verse 27. And Jesus went out, and his disciples into the towns or regions or vicinity of Caesarea Philippi. You know, I'm thrilled as I read that, because I'm just thinking I'll be up there next week. Looking forward to being there again. I've had the joy of being there many times. And Jesus went out and his disciples into the towns of Caesarea Philippi. The Savior and the disciples are leaving Bethsaida, where they're found in verse 22, and they're walking for 30 miles north of Bethsaida, right up into the open country of beautiful Caesarea Philippi, away up in the northern boundary of Israel towards Damascus. Its name had been called Panus for many centuries now, because it had been the center of the worship of the Greek god Pan. It's a very beautiful spot even today. A lovely scene of rock and river and lush vegetation. And it's located at the spring of the river Hermon that flowed at that time before the earthquake out of the mouth of a giant cave in the massive rocky escarpment. If you could imagine that this entire wall, and even bigger, was a gigantic cave, and there was this source of the River Jordan running out of it. What a tremendous scene it is. It's one of the three sources which join to form the River Jordan, and everybody knows that Jordan is symbolic of the time of death. When I tread the verge of Jordan, bid my anxious fear subside, bear me through the swelling torrent, land me safe on Canaan's side. What are we singing about? Death. Ah, but not the state of death, the time of death. And so Jordan is symbolic of the time of death. And we can see here something of the Savior's physical fitness. Friends, I've taken this journey, as I've said, often in an air-conditioned coach, with ice-cold Coca-Cola after a cool shower and plenty of deodorant and sun cream. And our Savior walked it without any of these things. No transport. It's a way up over the mountains of the Golan Heights, away up in the sweltering heat. And it's obvious to me as I go up there that our Lord Jesus Christ was a strong man. Strong man. And you would think the way that the artists portray him at times, that he was some sort of an effeminate genie. I can assure you that there's nothing effeminate about our wonderful Lord. He's the perfect man. Here he is walking for 30 miles. Now we can see not only his physical fitness in verse 27, but his mental alertness. By the way, he asked his disciples, saying unto them, whom do men say that I am? He was always aware of what was going on. He was always abreast of the news headlines, if you like. Of course, I know he's all-knowing. I know his omniscience meant that he knows everything. But after the manner of men, he was always inquiring, you see. He knew about the 18 people who were killed at the Tower of Siloam when it collapsed. He knew about the blood of the zealots that had been mingled with the blood of their sacrifices in the temple area when Pilate sent a squad in to deal with them. And he wants to know the popular opinion of the people concerning his identity. And he asks, whom do men say that I am? In verse 28, they answered, John the Baptist. But some say Elias, that's just the Greek way of saying the Hebrew word Elijah. And others, one of the prophets, they actually mention Jeremiah. There was something about the Lord's fearless, fiery, forthright preaching that reminded the people about Elijah, about John the Baptist, about Jeremiah, these fearless, fiery, forthright preachers of God's word. And then in verse 29, the Lord saith unto them, but whom say ye that I am? You see, he's coming a little closer now, isn't it? This isn't his physical fitness or his mental alertness, but his spiritual awareness. He's saying to our hearts this morning, what's your opinion? Who do you say that I am? Oh, I'm listening to boys singing King Jesus all over the place today. Listen, do you know why the half of them's calling him King Jesus? And remember, he's the King of the Jews. Because they can't call him Lord, because they won't do what he says. Ye call me Master and Lord, and you say, well, for so I am. What do you think about me this morning? That's what the Lord's saying. Whom do you say that I am? You see, he's in the midst this morning. Let's remind our hearts of that fact. And he's probing and searching our hearts in the meeting. And he's asking, what think ye of Christ? What's your conclusion? What's your judgment? What's your verdict? What's your response? That's an entirely different question. It's not enough for us to be familiar with the views of others or to be aware of what our friends say about him, whether it be true or false. Each one of us have a responsibility to know the Savior for ourselves. The Savior wants to know the answer just now as he gives us a heart operation. For the eyes of the Lord are running to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong in the behalf of them whose hearts are perfect towards him. And God knows our hearts without a word being spoken. And he's giving you a heart operation this morning. Peter speaks in verse 29. And Peter answereth and said unto him, thou art the Christ. The Greek word is Christos, the anointed, the Messiah. And if you want a full account of what's happening here, then look sometime at Matthew 16 and verse 13 onwards, and you'll find Peter's declaration of faith in full. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. You're both the Messiah and the Son of God. And that's what Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6 teaches us. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. The child is born, but the son wasn't born. The son was given, having neither beginning of days nor end of life. Oh, he's the pre-existent one. He's not only the son of man, but he's God the Son, the eternal Son. You'll find also in Matthew 16, the Lord's commendation of Peter and how that he imparts to him the keys of the kingdom, which Peter used at Pentecost in the house of Cornelius as well. He used that key as he preached the gospel and admitted both the Jews and Gentiles into the kingdom of God. And of course, you'll find there also the Lord's prophecy concerning the building of his church upon the rock of his deity. And remember, he said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Speaking of an event yet future at that time, I will build my church. So the church began at Pentecost, not Sinai, and is built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Now in verse 30, as Peter has confessed Christ, he charged them that they should tell no man of him. His deity was hidden at this time. Now look at verse 31. And he began, and I want to emphasize that word began. This is a new beginning. He began to teach them that the Son of Man must, look at the necessity in that word, must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders and of the chief priests and scribes and be killed and after 3 days rise again. And he spake that saying openly. Now what wonderful preaching is this? This has to be the gospel of the grace of God, surely. It's the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the gospel that Paul preached in 1 Corinthians 15, 1-4. How that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. And the Lord Jesus is beginning to preach this to the disciples away up there at Caesarea Philippi. He began to teach them. This is the first time that the Lord preached plainly to them of his soon coming suffering and rejection by the three categories of teachers who make up the Sanhedrin, the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes. But he's saying, I'm not going to stay dead. I'm going to rise again from the dead. And he did after 3 days and three nights. And he spake that saying, we're told, openly. Now, in the context, that doesn't mean publicly. It means plainly. There was nothing parabolic about it. The Lord was telling them straight out about his death, burial, and resurrection. Yes. This is the first time that he ever did this. This is a new thing. And the Lord is making the new beginning a right beginning. Now, please allow me to tell you what I've seen here. The Lord takes the disciples to the very source of the great Jordan River, the symbol of the time of death. And there, at that place, he begins to preach plainly that he's now going to the cross. His time of death has come. And the mind of the Savior is flooding here with thoughts of Calvary. And the Lord is starting from that furthermost part of Israel, away up at Caesarea Philippi. He's starting now to make his journey to the cross. He's taking the same route that the very Jordan River takes. He's saying, my time of death has come. And the Lord isn't hiding the cross, friend. He's preaching it right out into the open. He's not ashamed to own the cross. And he's going to speak in Mark's gospel 3 times altogether on his journey down to Jerusalem about the cross work that he must now endure. And each time he'll make a different emphasis. Here, the emphasis on the blindness of the teachers, because he says that he's going to be rejected. The elders and chief priests and scribes. In the next chapter, chapter 9, and verse 31, he tells them the same truth again. Only this time it says, for he taught his disciples and said unto them, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of men, and they shall kill him, and after that he's killed, he shall rise the third day. This time it's not the blindness of the teachers, it's the betrayal of the traitor. He says, I'm going to be delivered into the hands of men. And in the next chapter, chapter 10, he does this again. He takes them aside. Look at verse 32. And they were in the way going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus went before them, and they were amazed, and as they followed, they were afraid, and he took again the 12, and began to tell them what things should happen unto him, saying, behold, we go up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man shall be delivered unto the chief priests and unto the scribes, and they shall condemn him and put him to death, and shall deliver him to the Gentiles. Look at this. And they shall mock him and scourge him and spit upon him and shall kill him, and the third day he shall rise again. He knows the very spittle that they will spit upon him. The scourging whip, the crucifixion, the resurrection. There never was a time when the Lord didn't know all about the cross. And here it's not the blindness of the teachers or the betrayal of the traitor. It's the brutality of the tormentors. The Lord knows everything that he must suffer. And these are all aspects of the cross work of Christ. And sometimes we sing together, Jesus, keep me near the cross. And saved and unsaved, in this meeting and sitting, listening and watching me on video or whatever. If you're going to begin right today, then you're going to have to begin at the cross. There's a way back to God from the dark paths of sin. There's a door that is open where you may go in. It's at Calvary's cross is where you begin when you come as a sinner to Jesus. I've got to ask you, are you prepared to meet God? No. Are you determined to die in your sins? Jesus said, if you believe not that I am he, then you shall die in your sins. Whither I go, ye cannot come. And friend, there'll be no change in your experience in hell for all eternity. To lose one's wealth is much, to lose one's health is more. But to lose one's soul is such a loss that no man can restore. Take up thy cross. That's the call this morning. Christ is calling. Follow me. Amen.
Down from his glory, ever living story, my God and Savior came, and Jesus was his name. Born in a manger, to his own a stranger, a man of sorrows, tears, and agony. Redemption, that in the dead of night, not one faint hope in sight. God gracious, tender, laid aside his splendor, stooping to woe, to win, to save. My breath, my sunshine.